messages from Transformers Chapel. The altar at which lives are transformed and altered.
Remember what Moses said to Joshua and the children of Israel. Be not afraid, fear not, and be not dismayed.
Sit back and listen. Be inspired and blessed.
The most destructive enemy or element in human mind is fear.
This message is from Pastor David Adeoye.
Let's school ourselves in the school of understanding. Ephesians chapter 3. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ, Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles. I want you to take note of that first statement. He said, for this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles. Specific. Not to the Jews, but to the Gentiles. In other words, I've been tied to you. I have been ordained to minister to you. My assignment is to you, the Gentiles. So he called himself a prisoner. A prisoner is someone who cannot go beyond where he's been caged. Am I saying something? He cannot go out. Maybe he wants to go out, but he's caged. So in other words, Paul was saying, I am already caged. I am in prison already for you. I am not to step out of this place. If ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you word. The dispensation of the grace of God at work in his life, he said, was given to him towards the Gentiles. Praise God. How that by revelation he made known unto me the mysteries. As I wrote afore in few words. Whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Because Christ is actually a mystery. But Paul was able to break it down to the point where they will be able to understand and assimilate whatever revelation he got. And he was also attributing it to the grace of God. Praise God. Which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by his Spirit. Praise the Lord. You see, the reason why the Bible is the most relevant book is because of this. There are some things that will be preached in 100 years to come, amen, if Jesus tarries, that we will not hear at this generation. Are you getting me? That is, in this generation, we will not hear it. Are you getting what I'm saying? Praise the Lord. The things that Paul was talking about, nobody has ever talked about it. But it has been there. Which has been hid in the time past, but now be revealed by the Holy Ghost through the grace of God. Praise the Lord. That the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partaker of his promise in Christ by the gospel. When understanding comes, you become a partaker. Whereover was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who I am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world had been hidden God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. To the intent that now unto principalities and power in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God. Praise God. Now you see, it takes the grace of God upon his life for him to download heavenly agenda for mankind, which was hidden and nobody knew about it, according to the eternal purpose which God, which he proposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by faith in him. So when understanding comes, praise the Lord, you have boldness, praise the Lord, you have confidence, and you have faith to access what belongs to you. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. That was what Paul said. We are talking about grace for the race. 1 Corinthians. Chapter 15. Moreover, brethren, from verse 1, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, Paul speaking again, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, and if ye keep in memory what I preach unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, which is Peter. Then, take note of the order, he was seen of Cephas or Peter. Then the apostles, after that he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remained unto this present. That is, some of them are alive today, some are dead, and some are falling asleep. That is, they are now dead among the 500 people. You see, you can see the order. Peter, then the apostles, then about 500 men. Praise the Lord. After that, he was seen of James. And then all the apostles. And, number 8 now, verse 8, and last of all, he was seen of me. So he was the last person. Also. And the last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time. Verse 9, he said, for I am the least of the apostles, and that I am not meet to be called an apostle, but because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all. I was a last comer. But I have this unusual grace that made me to study beyond their level. Praise the Lord. I labor abundantly more than they all. He said, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. May this grace answer for you. Amen. Can I hear your amen? Amen? Now you can see that we have painted a vivid picture of what grace is all about in the life of Paul. And what he said. Praise the Lord. People were before him. People have been Christians and apostles before he even got converted. But when he came on the scene, something rested on him. And he began to do exploit. And he did exploit far better than the ones that he met. Overtaking is allowed when grace is at work. So if you understand it, grace, you will subscribe to it. So that you can receive a lift beyond where you are. Listen to me. God is going to catapult you to heights. I didn't hear your amen to that. I didn't hear your amen. Whether you met them or they met you in the name that is above all name, God will take you far above. I said God will take you far above. Whatever has granted you, whatever has not allowed you to move on, by the grace of God, that yoke shall be broken. I didn't hear your amen. So I want you to have good understanding, because Paul schooled them in understanding and connected them to their inheritance in Christ. Amen. That the eyes of understanding may be enlightened for you to know the reason why Christ came. Praise God. Praise the Lord. So he was emphasizing grace, that look at me. Look at where I am today. If you see me laboring like this, it is not me. It is the grace that was bestowed upon me. So great grace was not given to them. I don't know why. Why will a latecomer? Now he started. He had to analyze it for you to understand what he was talking about. He says, Cephas saw him first. All right? And then he talked about some apostles, some disciples. Am I right? Praise the Lord. And then 500 people. And then he was seen of James. Praise God. And then the last one was him. Praise the Lord. Nevertheless, he did exploit more than all of them. You will do exploit this year. I repeat, you will do exploit this year. What is grace? Grace simply means God's unmerited favor. Number two, grace, I said that before, grace is what qualifies the unqualified. You don't have to know to do it. When grace is upon you, begin to manifest under the power of that grace. Can somebody shout amen? Amen. May the grace of God work for you. May the grace of God work for you. Grace helps you to do the unusual. Praise the Lord. Now, what will grace do for you? Let's itemize them and let's enumerate them one after the other. Amen. These are some of the operations of grace in the lives of Christians. Praise the Lord. Number one is that grace saves. It's good you understand that. Grace saves. Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 4 through to 9. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, or in sins, he quickened us together with Christ. By grace he has saved, and had raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Amen? Verse 7, it says, that in the age to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. For by grace he has saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Praise the Lord. And the good thing is that you have that gift already. Can I hear your amen? I said you have that gift already. He said, not of works, lest any man should boast. So no one qualifies for it, and no one can work for it. Praise the Lord. So salvation is a gift of God. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. I said the other time, I think in the course of last week, I don't know why Judas was the one who betrayed Jesus Christ. Why will he be the one? And today, I've never had anybody bearing Judas. Am I saying something? Praise the Lord. Because of what we know about Judas. Nobody wants to name their child Judas. Am I saying something? Praise God. Because of what he did. Praise the Lord. Now, if you know the prophecy very well, it is not an animal who will fulfill that prophecy. It's a human being. So why will he be the one that fell victim? Are you getting what I'm saying? You heard what he said. Jesus Christ was talking. He said, all the people you have given unto me, I have kept, except the son of perdition. He was referring to Judas. He could not tame Judas. Why? Because he has a strange anointing that will not be tamed. And you know, in Kikuyu adage, a dog that will be lost will not hear the whistle of his yoga. No matter how you bridle them, you know, there are some people like that. No matter how you work on them, are you getting me? They will still go to their vomits. So why will be Judas? I want to believe that mercy will prevail for that guy. Because God will say, I just used you, so you cross to heaven. Because that has to be fulfilled. Because Jesus needed to die to take away the sins of man. So by the shedding of blood will be the remission of sin. Because without the shedding of blood, there will be no remission of sin. So somebody has to introduce him to the people who will kill him. But I don't want to be that person. Praise God. I said, praise the Lord. And if you are born again, it means you are in the club of the grace that God talks about. Praise the Lord. So that means grace will work for you. Amen. Because if you are not born again, and those who are outside, some of them will be born again, and some of them will not be. Amen? He said, by grace ye are saved. Not because of yourself or the works that you did. No, it's not about works. You can't work for salvation. The Holy Ghost is the one that convicts people. He just enters. No matter how hard you are just convicted. That grace fell upon him. The man who was persecuting the church, a murderer. He said, the Lord. You heard what he said when he was saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said something. He said, who are you, Lord? So he knew that God was talking to him. The grace was already at work. And Saul yielded his life to God, and God used him mightily, even though he was a latecomer. Praise God. I don't know why God is interested in something that is the last. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I wish I was the last born of my father. The battle with the firstborn is heavy. Am I saying something? You fight a lot of battles. Check the Bible. Praise God. But the last one is cared for. Nobody beats them. Amen? He eats with the father on the table. You know what I'm talking about. The father takes him out. What the first, second, third did not enjoy. They enjoy it. Praise God. I said, praise the Lord. God is always interested in someone that has nothing. God is always interested in someone that is poor. Somebody that has nothing. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes,
I don't know why.
Yes.
You know, Jesus Christ said, the last will be the first, and the first will be the last.
Yes.
You didn't say that in scriptures?
Yes,
praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Number two, grace empowers. Grace translates to the power of the Holy Spirit and is given to every one of us to fulfill destiny. Don't forget 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 3. He said, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue. Praise the Lord. So everything will be accessed, amen, by the grace. Praise God. And Titus chapter 2, from verse 11 to 12, he said, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation had appeared to all men. So it's grace that brings salvation. Teaching us that deny ungodliness and worldly lust, it's the grace. You used to drink beer before, but when you see a bottle like this, you can't touch it. Something has come upon you. Are you getting what I'm saying? Oh, you used to smoke. You're a chest smoker. But when you encounter Christ, you drop smoking. It looks as if you cannot deliver yourself because you have to smoke. You know, I used to have some friends. Once they finish eating like this, they must smoke. If not, their body will be vibrating. Smoke must come after food. That is what we digest the food. Addiction. But God delivered them. Can I hear your amen? I said, can I hear your amen?
Amen.
Can I hear your amen?
Amen?
Can I hear your amen?
Amen?
There's one greater man of God in Nigeria today. When he was in the university, very bright guy, but a serious drunkard. I mean, he would drink to stupor on a daily basis. Praise God. That's the father in the Lord, the father of Sam Adeyemi. I don't know whether you know, Desta. In Lagos. Praise the Lord. But God turned his life around. He became a vibrant preacher. The last time I traveled, I saw him. Praise God. May the Lord empower you with his grace. Now look at this. Look at how grace works. Eh? How grace empowers. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, the Macedonian church, from verse 1 to 3, and we read verse 9. Moreover, brethren, we do you wit of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. The grace bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. How that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy. All right? You see, it takes grace to rejoice when you are going through turbulent times. Not that you are pretending, but you are just happy. Are you getting me? It takes grace. There was a lot of persecution. Their great trial of affliction. And the abundance of their joy. Not just that. And their deep what? Poverty. Abounded unto the riches of their liberality. He said, for to their power, Paul was speaking, I bear record. Yea, and beyond their power, they were willing of themselves. So it takes grace for a man to go beyond what he can do. Are you with me? That must be grace. Serious persecution. They were in terrible affliction. And their deep poverty. And they were still willing to give. Praise God. Beyond their power. So that's the grace. The grace was bestowed on them. I said something the other time. I said, for you to prosper, you'll be engraced to grief. Are you getting me? But if you cannot do it, it means you don't have grace. Are you getting me? If you don't have grace to release out of what he has given you. You see, how can I give you something? I said, take. When I come back, I will tell you something. All right? And I said, okay. I gave you 10 things. Give me one. You take 9. You said, for what? Am I not the one that gave it to you? Even the bread you are using and the strength, I'm the one who gave you. And I've given you 9. And I said, give me 1. And you are saying no. That means you lack grace. So a man that will prosper must have grace to give. If he does not have grace to give, he cannot prosper. Now listen to me. You see, for the fact that somebody has 10 cars does not mean that he has prospered. It is not in material things. Because there are people who have estates, who have skyscrapers. Are you getting me? But they are being tormented on a daily basis. You are even living better than them. So it's not in a big house. Somebody may be in a big house with a big affliction. And you know, one thing about sickness and disease, the rich people are the one who carries all manner of serious dangerous sickness and disease.
That's right.
Parkinson's disease. When you hear that. Something syndrome. You don't see that among poor people. why the Bible says, don't heavy sinners. So it's not about having great material things, but about contentment. When you live and sleep in your floor, not your small bed, it's like you are sleeping on water bed. And by the time you woke up, you woke up with joy. Whereas, the one who claims to be rich cannot sleep at night. He's tormented. The rich also cry. I've encountered few of them who will come to you and be shedding tears like this. I don't know why. I said, if this is what riches translate, that kind of riches I don't want. So you see that. That's why everyone who wants to prosper must ask for that grace to go beyond their power. Are you getting what I'm saying? Because without it, you cannot prosper. It takes the grace to give to magnetize the grace to prosper. Yes. So you cannot truly prosper without the grace to give. Anything you cannot give to God is your God. It's something you are worshiping. So in their great affliction, in their deep poverty, they were still giving. Are you getting me? Yes, and they were the one begging the apostles to take. Yes, it takes grace to do that. Grace empowers. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And verse 9 says, for ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that although he was rich, yet for your sakes he became what? Poor. It takes grace for a man to do that. That ye through his poverty might be rich. That somebody had to pay the price to take your place of poverty. He left his riches and he left his house and he was on the street. How many can do that? It takes grace. Praise the Lord. And in Acts chapter 4, from verse 3 to 35, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked. For as many as were possessor of lands and houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold. Verse 35. And laid them down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. The grace was too much. That they began to sell houses and brought the money, give it to those who don't have. How many can do that? True grace empowers to give. Number 3 is that grace deters. I'm expanding that. I started that in the course of the week. It deters. Grace deters. Amen? D-E-T-E-R-S. To stop something, to block something, to hinder something. All right? Grace also hinders things from happening. Do you understand? Grace stops things. It restrains. Now I give you, let me just read to you Genesis chapter 20. Genesis 20 from verse 1. And Abraham journeyed from thence towards south country and dwelt between Kadesh and Shur and sojourned in Gerar. And Abraham said unto Sarah, Sarah, his wife. She is my sister. And Abimelech, the king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. Verse 3. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said unto him, behold, thou art but a dead man. For the woman which thou hast taken, for she is a man's wife. And Abimelech had not come near her and said, Lord, will thou slay also a righteous nation? Said he not unto me, she is my sister. But the man told me that Sarah is his sister. Why will you kill me for something I didn't know? And she even of herself said, he is my brother. In the integrity of my heart and innocence of my hands have I done this. And God said unto him in a dream, yea, I know that thou did this in the integrity of thy heart. For I, look at this. This is where grace deters. For I, God, also withheld thee from sinning against me. So I am the one who stopped you, even though you slept till daybreak. I restrain you. I paralyze your manhood. You cannot perform. Are you hearing me? He said, I am the one who did it. Therefore, suffer I not thee to touch her. Did you see her? I'm the one who restrain you from touching her. He said, now therefore, restore the man his wife. For he is a prophet, and he shall pray for thee, and thou shalt live. And if thou restore her not, know thou that thou shalt surely die. Thou and all that are dying. All of you will die. Therefore, Abimelech rose early in the morning and called all his servants and told all these things in their ears. And the men were so afraid. And Abimelech called Abraham and said unto him, what hast thou done unto us? What have I offended thee that thou hast brought on me and on my kingdom a great sin? Thou hast done deeds unto me that ought not to be done. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Whatever belongs to you that the enemy wants to take, grace will deter. Amen. I didn't hear your amen. Amen. I said, I didn't hear your amen. When they see your car parked at the parking lot, grace will deter them from touching it. Amen. I didn't hear your amen. Amen. When anything of you get lost, in the name of Jesus, grace will that deter them from stealing it. Amen. Can I hear your amen? Amen? Somebody traveled to Dubai, and as she got to the airport, she forgot $15,000 right on the floor where she was removing her things at the Dubai airport. She went to town. It was when she has bought something she wanted to pay that she discovered that the money was not there. She started crying. So she rushed to the airport. The money was found. Praise God. Whatever you have lost, God will bring it back. Grace will bring it back. I said, grace will bring it back. Do you know that Laban had the power to hurt Jacob? Amen? But somehow grace stopped him. In Genesis 31 verse 29, he said, it is in my power, it is in the power of my hand to do you hurt. He said, but God of your father spake unto me yesterday night, saying, don't touch Jacob. Praise God. Anyone planning evil for you, God will appear to them at night. Amen. And say, if you touch my son or my daughter, you are a dead man. Grace deters. Amen? You know the story in Numbers chapter 23. Balak hired Balaam to curse the people of God. Isn't it? And then he took out that assignment. I believe he must have been paid. For someone to follow the king, Balak, to say, okay, I will go and curse them. That means he wants to curse them. Are you getting me? But as he was saying, all of you with that, you will leave. Amen? Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Balak was very mad. In Numbers, look at the stories for the whole chapter, from verse 7. And he took up his parable, because God had told Balaam what he would tell him when the first encounter came, and said, Balak, the king of Moab, had brought me from Haran, out of the mountains of the east, saying, come, curse me Jacob, and come and defile Israel. Verse 8, how shall I curse whom God has not cursed? And how shall I defile whom the Lord has not defiled? Verse 11, and Balak said unto Balaam, what hast thou done unto me? I took thee to curse my enemies, and behold, thou hast blessed them altogether. Verse 13, and Balak said unto him, come, I pray thee. Okay, he thought maybe the man was still, he said he's still balanced. Okay, he said, come, I pray thee, with me unto another place, from whence thou mayest see them. Thou shalt see but the uttermost part of them, and shall not see them all. And curse me them from thence. And he brought him into the field of Zophim, to the top of Pisgah, and built 7 altars. So he was actually doing it to curse the people. And offered a bullock and a ram on every altar. And he said unto Balak, stand here by thy burnt offerings, while I meet the Lord yonder. Verse 16, and the Lord met Balaam, and put a word in his mouth, and said, go again unto Balak, and say thus. And when he came to him, behold, he stood by his burnt offering, and the princes of Moab with him. And Balak said unto him, what has the Lord spoken? And he took up his parable and said, rise up, Balak, and hear. Hearken unto me, thou son of Zippor. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Has he said it? And shall he not do it? Or had he spoken, and shall he not make it good? He said, behold, I have received a commandment to bless, and I had blessed, and I cannot reverse it. And he had not beheld the iniquity of Jacob, neither had he seen perverseness of Israel. Did you see that? Grace was working for them. He said, God has not beheld the iniquity of Jacob, neither had he seen the perverseness of Israel. He said, the Lord, his God, is with him. God is with you. And the shout of a king is among them. God brought them out of Egypt. He had, as it were, the strength of a unicorn. Surely, verse 23, there is no enchantment against Jacob, neither is there any divination against Israel. According to this time, it shall be said of Jacob and of Israel, what God has done. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Grace deters. Look at another example of how great it is. Saul pursued David for 15 years to kill him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. How many years? 15. He was pursuing the boy for 15 solid years, but he could not kill him. Instead, Saul died. David was 15 when he had an encounter with Saul. And after he killed Goliath, and the women began to sing, hey, Saul has killed how many thousand? One. And then David has killed his 10,000. And then he said, okay, the way these people are singing, it appears they will make this boy a king one day. I need to finish him. And he cast the javelin the first time. Amen? Grace prevented it. Are you getting me? And then from there, he organized a coup for David to kill him. A dinner. But that day, grace prevailed. Jonathan revealed the secret. And David ran away. And from there, Saul began to chase this boy. With his army, he began to chase this boy. But grace will not allow David to be killed. And about 15 years, Saul died. Anyone who has been pursuing you, who has not relented, you have talked to them, you have prayed for them, and they say, no, I will kill you. They will die before your time.
Amen. I didn't hear your amen. Amen. I said, I didn't hear your amen. Amen. I said, I didn't hear your amen. Amen.
Now, can you imagine someone that you have actually helped? You had the opportunity to actually kill him. You didn't kill him, but God, he killed himself. Isn't it? David had the opportunity twice to kill the man. He cut the skirt. And when he got to a very far place, he said, Saul, oh God, Saul, my father, look at your clothes. I will have killed you. Saul never repented. Every unrepentant witch, amen, God will finish them. Amen. Can I hear your amen? So when you have this grace, you know, one of the definitions of grace is that grace makes you unkillable and unstoppable. They will try, but they will not succeed. They will try many times, they will not succeed. Rather, they will eat themselves. Can I hear your amen? Amen? That's what grace does. May the grace of God work for you. I didn't hear your amen. Number four, we are going to 10, but I'm not sharing the 10. I will share the balance in the second service. Grace influences our actions. Now, this is one of the most common works of grace in our lives. And I'm going to cite two scriptures example quickly to lay this foundation. In 2 Chronicles chapter number 32, I will read from verse 27 to 31. Chronicles is in the New Testament after Revelation. If you open to Revelation, you'll get it. Somebody is opening to the back. Are you 2 Chronicles 32? Look at it from verse 27. And Hezekiah had exceeding much riches and honor. And he made himself treasures or treasuries of silver and for gold and for precious stones and for spices and for shields and for all manner of pleasant jewels and storehouses also for the increase of corn and wine and oil and stalls for all manner of beasts. That's like the cars of their days. All manner of beasts. There's a car even called beast, a Mercedes. Amen? And coats of flocks. Verse 29. Moreover, he provided him cities and possession of flocks and herd in abundance. For God had given him substance very much. Very famous guy. This same Hezekiah also stopped the upper water course of Gihon and brought it straight down to the west side of the city of David. That's like a dam, Nairobi water. And Hezekiah prospered in all his works. How be it in the business of the ambassadors of the princes of Babylon, who sent unto him to inquire of the wonders that was done in the land. God left him to try him that he might know all that was in his heart. Now go to 2 Kings chapter 20 from verse 12 to 18. And at that time, Berodach Beladan, the son of Beladan, king of Babylon, sent letters and present unto Hezekiah, for he had heard that Hezekiah had been sick. And Hezekiah hearkened unto them and shewed them all the houses of his precious things, the silver and the gold and the spices and the precious ointment and all manner of and all the house of his armor and all that was found in his treasuries. There was nothing in his house nor in all his dominion that Hezekiah showed them not. And Then King Isaiah came unto King, Isaiah the prophet, unto King Hezekiah, and said unto him, what said this man? And from whence came they unto thee? And Hezekiah said, they are come from a far country, even from Babylon. And he said, what have they seen in thy house? And Hezekiah answered, all the things that were in my house were seen. And there is nothing among my treasury that I have not showed them. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. I'm going to read the balance of it later. This happens to be the story of a righteous king, Hezekiah, whom God blessed with exceeding riches and honor. And his fame was not just a national fame. It was known internationally. He was so wealthy. Praise the Lord. And when the king of Babylon heard that he had recovered from his sickness, you know, in Isaiah chapter 38, he was actually sick. Amen? Are you getting me? When they say he will die. Are you getting what I'm saying? You know the story very well. And Isaiah came to him that God says, put your house in order, you will die. But he faced God and prayed to God. I said, why will you do me this? And God said, I've added 15 more years. Isn't it? Praise the Lord. So after the recovery, the king of Babylon now sent some emissaries, like ambassadors or some envoy. Amen? To go with present to King Hezekiah. And stupid enough, Hezekiah embraced them because Babylons are enemies of God's people. And then he began to show them all the treasuries. He began to reveal his secrets, not knowing that they were spies planning for an attack. Now, the Bible says God left him to try his heart. In other words, grace left him for a while. Grace was suspended to know what is in his heart. Some of the times God can try us like that. Praise the Lord. So unknown to Hezekiah, he revealed all his secrets, all his armory, everything he showed them. God was trying to see whether Hezekiah was a proud show-off or a humble man. But he was so proud to show them everything. Praise the Lord. So true to God's expectation, in 2 Kings chapter 20 from verses 12 and 13, he shows that it was a show-off guy. Praise the Lord. Hear what Isaiah said, verse 16. And Isaiah said unto him, Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord. Behold, the day come that all that is in thy house and that which thy father had laid up in stores unto this day shall be carried into Babylon. Nothing shall be left, said the Lord. And of thy sons that shall issue from thee, which thou shalt beget, they shall be taken away, and they shall be eunuch in the palace of the king of Babylon. If you read Daniel, you will see that. They became slaves. So this act actually brought in the devil or the enemy to take everything. Praise God. God was trying his heart. Now the lesson to learn from this is that when grace is absent, the natural man is completely unpredictable and unreliable. He will fail, he will fall because of very little temptation. That's why people fall into temptation. Just little thing like this can sweep some people off. That's why it is dangerous not to have grace at all times. It is dangerous to frustrate the grace of God because grace can be frustrated by us. So So we need to know that God's grace influences our positive actions, our decisions, and choices on a daily basis. So this is the reason why we must visit the throne of grace at all times, on a daily basis, which is prayer. Come to the throne of grace. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16. This is why we need to subscribe for that grace. Every day, you pray to God. Praise God. To apply for grace for the day. I don't want to make mistakes here. Praise God. I don't want to blunder. Praise the Lord. When grace is not at work, you blunder. When grace is not at work, you lose money. Are you getting what I'm saying? Some people will even lose their life because grace was absent. So we need to constantly visit the throne of grace in prayers on a daily basis to receive grace for the race. Praise the Lord. May you receive grace for the race. Can I hear your amen? Amen. So you see, that blunder, just trying to embrace friends, not knowing that it was embracing enemy. Some people can embrace enemy like that, as friends into their homes. She's my good friend, childhood friend, and then he collects your husband. And then the woman takes over the bedroom, and then the man kicks you out. Are you getting what I'm saying? Have you not seen that happen? Somebody say, oh, there's a lucrative business here. Let's put money. And then you sold your house and then you put money inside. Grace left you. I told you how somebody told me. He said, one man came to him. They came for prayers because they have, their house has gone for it and their car. Somebody brought negatives of dollars to be washed. So he washed one in their presence. He says the little chemical that is remaining. So he washed one or two. He said, these are genuine dollars. You go and spend it, you see. Stupid enough, they went to spend it. Everything was okay. So the man said, look, we need chemical for New York. The man that will bring it is from UN and some from New York. And we need about 5 million to buy the chemical to wash these negatives. He brought them in boxes. They sold the house to get him the money. The moment the man took the money, he switched off. And they now came for prayers. God doesn't answer that kind of prayers. Why will you be so stupid enough? I used to say that there is no money doubler that can get me. Are you getting me? If I am a money doubler, I won't tell you. That is, if true, money can be doubled. I will just be doubling whatever I have. Only me. I will double. I don't need to tell anybody. I'll just double the one I have. I double it and I double it. I won't let anybody know. I double it. So the moment somebody comes to you and says, look, when you put in this, this one can happen. You buy negative. So why can't he go and look for money and wash the negatives? Why will he bring it? So that means you are a dullard. Yes. You are not even supposed to be a Christian. You are supposed to be a Muslim, knocking your head 5 times on the floor. So that the head can break very fast. So I said, what kind of prayer do you want me to pray? You are stupid. So when grace is absent, men begin to behave anyhow. And then you see a man running after a house girl. For what? And you have a beautiful wife, house help, dirty and tattered. Why? Because his brain has been suspended because grace has left him. He's now seeing a beautiful girl in a house girl. You see? And Christians fall victim because grace will not leave you. Amen. Can I hear your amen? Amen? So you saw what Ezekiah brought to his generation. They became slaves in Babylon. And they carried away everything that he ever labored for. Praise God. I said, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But the good thing is that those things were gotten back. Amen? Those things were gotten back. In the days of Zechariah, the governor of Jerusalem, praise the Lord. Even though it took them 18 years, praise the Lord. But Cyrus restored back all the things, amen, that they took in the days of Hezekiah. He gave them back to go and take it back to Jerusalem because God touched his heart to do it. everything you have lost will come back. Can I hear your amen? So you see what grace is all about. This grace will work for you. So that's why we need to subscribe for grace every day. Every day. Every day. The throne room of grace. That we may obtain mercy. Amen? And find grace for our needs. Praise the Lord. That's why it's good for you to come on Wednesday and on Friday. To come and ask for this grace. Oh, the kind of prayer we pray, they are very interesting prayers. But you don't have access to it because you're not here. You think Sunday is the only day that God visits people. Praise God. It's not about crowd. Amen? Take time out and look for grace. This grace will work for you.
Hope you enjoyed, touched, and blessed to your next level. Worship with us at Transformers Chapel. We are situated on Kilimani Road, Elsie Plaza, Ofeligeo Marakwet, Adams Arcade Roundabout. Visit us on our website, www.transformerschapel.org, or our Facebook page, Transformers Chapel, Nairobi.